next speaker would be Dr. Will Williams. No vacations, no nothing. Get out there.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Before I get off of this course, I just want to make some acknowledgments. First, our dean and our president is not here because they are part of their delegation, maybe a couple other folks who went down to Oceanside to go to a memorial for Dr. Beth Volpe, who was the wife of Dennis Volpe, who died. She had been ill for a long time. She was battling cancer for a long time. And for Dennis's brother, Dr. Don Volpe, he was killed.
Dan Volpe.
He was killed in a motorcycle accident in Mesa, Arizona. The odd thing about it is that both of these two deaths occurred like within 4 or 5 hours of each other on the same day. So it was kind of a shock, because I heard it off of Facebook, and it was just, and I think the man, Dan Volpe, just had a birthday just not too long ago, recently before that. So that was quite shocking. So because of that, there's a lot of people that came from across the country.
Yeah.
To go to the memorial. And these folks, they were longtime students. I mean, they were back in the day when Dr. Kinley was walking, you know. So, I mean, they go back years. And, they're white. And see, they go, and another thing I want to bring up, Dr. Wilbur Carr, he died recently. Mm-hmm. Dr. Wilbur Carr was a longtime student. He was white. He was one of the first early white members of the school back in the 1940s, when I told you the story when they used to have meetings in the church and they got bricked and bombed by the Ku Klux. He was in the audience.
Yeah.
Okay. And I had the pleasure of meeting him a few years ago, and I did a video interview with him. And you can look at the video interview on Carla Kinley's website, thepatternofeverything.org. You can go there and go to the interview section and go to Wilbur Carr. We went to his house. It was really great. He and his wife, Meredith, were very gracious and hospitable, and this guy was just a wealth of information as far as the school, what happened, because, they live in Springfield, Ohio. Mm-hmm. And this was, when did we go there? It was 2003. And we was at the house, and it was like, the interview was like, it was a couple hours long, because I had one of my old cameras. I did it on a VHS camera, so. Mm-hmm. And we were there, while we was having the interview, his wife, Miss Meredith, she was cooking, in the kitchen, and after the interview was over, she brought us in together. I know y'all gonna eat, so he brought us in there. It was a great time. And they was just so hospitable. But the thing about it was, with him, he knew everything. I mean, if you wanted to know anything about the school from the 1940s on up, he was the guy to talk to, Dr. Mm-hmm. Wilbur Carr. So I just wanted to make acknowledgments on that. And he says there's a lot of folks from across the country that are down in Oceanside now. I kind of wish I was there, because I know a lot of these folks. I wish I could, but we sent our delegation and our love and our condolences, and so. And it's also a good excuse for a class, a seminar, a convention type stuff, because that's what they're going to talk about.
Yeah, it's
not going to be like, oh, it's so sad. And no, they're going to get up here, they're going to have these charts up, I'm willing to bet. Mm-hmm. Because that's where they were at. That's what they were about. When I die and I have a funeral, hey, it ain't a funeral as far as I'm concerned. It's a class.
Yeah.
You can set me up in a chair with a joint in my hand and a Guinness in the other, and you have the charts behind. I don't care, An Irish way, you do whatever you want. You can say anything you want about me, good or bad. Mm-hmm. Have the charts up and just say, this is what I'm about.
Right.
That's I don't care. That's class. That's what I want. Right. Cremate me, carry me back to my hometown of Alton, Illinois, and dump me in the Mississippi River.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
As far as I'm concerned, let the fishes eat. You go fishing in the river, pull you up a catfish, give a minute, say, hey, it might be a little bit of will. Now, I want to try to encapsulate some of this and address some of the things the first speaker brought up, and feel free, it's not that many of us, feel free to interject if you want, or something, but basically, I want to say this. As far as this doctrine, what we believe in, what you see illustrated on these charts, is so not of the world. You know, mm-hmm. What I mean by that is that what we say is totally opposite to what the world is saying.
Mm-hmm.
See, the world say God, we say Yahweh. The world say Jesus, we say Yahshua. See, the world say you got to do follow his example, we say he brought the examples to a head. The world says Revelations is the written word of things to come. We say it's already
right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
See? And so the thing about it is this. While there are many versions of the Bible, we heard a different version up here, the Ryrie. I got a Scofield with his holy name. Some people have King James, there's other versions. See, while there are many versions of the Bible, there's only one prophetic vision,
mm-hmm.
okay? And that corrects all the versions of the Bible, mm-hmm. see? Because all versions have errors. There's no, I would love someone to show me a perfect Bible because I will point out the error in it. I don't care what it is. You show me what, I'll point the errors out. For this simple reason, every Bible is slanted toward the translator.
Mm-hmm.
So now, how then are you going to ascertain what's in the book? Because, see, everybody reads the Bible. And everybody has their own interpretation of what's in the Bible. In this country, you are guaranteed by law to interpret the Bible any way you want. First Amendment. Or not believe at all. And that's a big phenomenon. Even the founder talked about that. People not believing in anything at all. Atheists. The rise of atheism. I mean, I was listening to a tape the other day, and he was mentioning it then, and this was like in the late 60s when he was talking about it then, and it's more so now, and they even mentioned it in the election because they said there was like a certain amount of number, a percentage of people that were not affiliated with any religious, atheist, agnostic, that voted for Obama. I mean, in other words, what they were saying was that he had put together this coalition of different groups, you know, the atheists and the agnostics, the homosexuals, the blacks, the women, mm-hmm. the Asians, the Hispanics, you know.
Yeah.
In other words, 21st century America.
Yeah.
Whereas the Republicans came off like 19th century America.
Right.
See. And for a long time, that strategy worked. But see, as my economics geography professor told me, she told me, she said, hey, demographics is destiny.
Mm-hmm.
It's mm-hmm. that simple. It's a matter of arithmetic.
Yeah.
If you can't count, then you can't see what's going on as far as what's happening in this country.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, but I want to bring this up as far as certain things that were said. Well, first of all, get John 5, or Revelations 5, I mean, not Revelations, Romans 5. Mm-hmm. Let me knock this off like quick. Because, see, when Yahweh created this creation, and look, what we read in Genesis is not the actual creation. This is Yahweh showing it to Moses, because when Moses up here, the creation is already made.
Yeah.
He's just showing it in a rerun. And look, it didn't take Yahweh 6 days to create it. It took Yahweh 6 days to show it to Moses.
Right.
Because, see, the creation came in quicker than, I mean, you can't even bat your eye fast enough for the creation coming in with everything in it. But see, he slowed it down
mm-hmm.
for Moses. And it took Moses 6 solar days to see this thing unfold. Mm-hmm. And then on the 7th day, he called Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
Yeah.
Which is recorded in Genesis as on the 7th day, Elohim rested from his work. See, this is not the actual account of the creation. This is just a rerun for Moses' sake.
Recapitulation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And that's what that is. See, so what we see, and that's the error. And see, that's another option. See, the world thinks, oh, this is the actual creation.
Mm-hmm.
No, it ain't.
Mm-hmm.
Here's another thing, because it was mentioned about this millions of years things, you know, because people say, well, you know, the earth, because mankind says the universe is like 11 billion years old or something like that. Okay, so how do you account for that? Well, see, look, this is what, and we say the opposite. We say this, because see, the conservative religious people will say the earth is like 6,000 years old. Now, we'll say that's how, you know, that's what, according to the Bible, that's what written history is, but see, but actually what we say is, you can't tell me, or anybody, how old this universe is, for this simple reason. Matter is spirit materialized.
Right.
See? From abstract to incorporeal to concrete. See, it's all spirit. Spirit in the abstract, spirit in the incorporeal, spirit in the physical. So now if that be the case, see, and Yahweh is spirit, and spirit is eternal, then you cannot determine the age of the universe. Because to determine the age of the universe will be like trying to determine the age of Yahweh. And you can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
See? It would be like looking at the analogy our founder used a lot would be like this. He would say, it's like looking at a watch and looking at the watch trying to determine how old the watchmaker is. You know? And it doesn't work like that. See, not with spirit. Mm-hmm. Now here's what man tries to do. See, man has come up with this. Carbon-14 dating. What is that? See, carbon is the sixth element on the periodic table of elements. And it is the element that is pertinent for life. It is the most common element in organic matter. Okay? Now, when organic matter dies, see, it decays. When it decays, it gives off electrons, particles. See, in other words, that can be detected. All right? And see, and it gives it off at a particular rate so that they can judge how old an object is. And that's that's what they do. You know, they get an object and they get the carbon-14 dating and they see how much the rate of the electrons go, or how much has decayed, and how much it has decayed. And that's how they determine the age of something. Okay? Now, and that's why they say, oh, well, you know, carbon-14 dating says, well, this bone here, this dinosaur bone we found here is 50 million years old, you know, because we carbon dated it and we saw the rate of decay, you know, so forth and so on. That's what they say. Here's the problem with that. This system is really only accurate up to 6,000 years. Mm-hmm. Beyond that is speculation. Now, there's controversial arguments about that, and you can find arguments for both sides of, you know, of the validity of this. But from what I've understood, you know, even the guy who came up with it said that it was only accurate up to a certain, you know, certain point. See, but and beyond that, it can get fuzzy. But see, the scientists, they want to keep it that way because, see, there's a vested interest in the theory of evolution. People make money at it. They make money. I mean, schools and research, you know, and stuff. There's money in science.
Mm-hmm.
And the theory of evolution, and look, that's why, like, you know, it's funny. Because, see, I look at these conservative religious people and, you know, and like, and you know, it's funny because some of the things they'll say, I admittedly would have to agree with. Because conservative religious people believe this. They believe that man and dinosaurs coexisted with each other. We do too. Mm-hmm. Our founder preached on it.
Mm-hmm.
But see, the world looks at that and they say that's crazy. Because they believe in carbon-14 dating and millions of years and the theory of evolution. So you look like a religious zealot or a nut.
Mm-hmm.
Because they read the Bible and they read the Bible and it's, what is it at? It's in Genesis.
11 chapter.
Uh-huh. First chapter about the, what did I do with my glasses?
Is it in your case?
No, it's in my pocket. No, first chapter. That's first chapter of Genesis is what I want. I think it's the fifth day. First 1 and 20. Somebody.
And Elohim said, let the water swarm with swarms of living creatures and birds that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of the heavens. And Elohim created a great sea monsters.
Mm-hmm.
And every living creature that swarms, with which the water swarmed. after their kind, and every winged bird after his kind.
Now see, that's the key. Mm-hmm. After their kind.
Yeah.
See, after their kind. In other words, they were created to be whatever they were, and that's what they became. See, the scientists will say this, that birds evolved from dinosaurs. Mm. That's what the scientists would tell you. Mm. See, man evolved from apes or the primates, as they say. See, mm. See, and I mean, when I say, well, if we evolved from monkeys, how come there are monkeys still around?
Right?
Mm-hmm. You know? Or at the very least, it should be, you know, some type of throwback, you know, like two humans, they had a half-ape baby, you know, because if we descended from them and got genetic, you know, then it should be a throwback or something, you know?
Yeah.
But I will never see that happening, you know, not like that. But see, a seed bearing seed after its own kind, mm-hmm. See, it answers the question of the old question, which came first, the chicken or the egg? It's obvious. The chicken. Because you gotta have the chicken, and then she lays an egg, bearing seed after its own kind. Mm-hmm. You know? So the chicken had to come first. See, these animals had to come first. But the problem is, see, man, you know, these scientists, they smile. And look, you have to also remember, too, that these people are satanically inspired as well. So they're not going to, there are folks that really do want to know the truth and do real research, but they're also folks that got their own vested interests as well.
Yeah.
To keep the truth from you, because as the scripture says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Mm-hmm. See? And look, and that works on any level, whether it's spiritual or physical. If you have lack of knowledge of how to fix your car, then you need to go to a mechanic and pay somebody to do it. Mm-hmm. If you don't know anything about it. Or whatever it is, see, okay? Now, here's another thing, and this is that I'm just trying to explain some things that the way Dr. Kinley explained it, all right, from what I've understood. See, that man was a giant, that's another thing. See, the scientists will tell you that man started off as a dwarf and then grew, you know, but see, with Dr. Kinley, see, he said, no, man started off as a giant and he shrunk, okay? See, so everything we're talking about is opposite of what the world is talking about. But the thing about it is, we feel we can prove what we're saying because we have a divine pattern in operation. Mm-hmm. See? Now, did I ask for Romans? Yeah.
Yes.
Let me get that out of the way. Romans
5
and 12.
12.
Yeah.
Wherefore, by one man, sin entered into the
world. Now, by one man, sin entered into the world. Now, what man was that? That was Adam. Now, the question you want to ask is, well, what is sin? Sin is transgression of the law.
Mm-hmm.
Now, while it is true that Satan was cast down here, down to this earth, you see, we got it illustrated here. Here he is in ethereal darkness, the unformed earth, okay? But see, but for him, this is a prison. See, this is a prison. See, this is the bottomless pit. See, look. There are three heavens. See, you have space, atmosphere, or the firmament, and then eternity. So Lucifer is cast down here to the first heaven, which is the bottomless pit. Mm-hmm. See, this is the prison for him. But as far as sin, see, there's no sin committed on Mother Earth.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. See, there's no transgression. See, and look, and when Yahweh created everything, at the end of it all, he said everything was good
and
very good. Mm-hmm. And listen, Lucifer was out here, that included him too.
Yeah.
Despite the fact that what his job, and look, he is good and very good for what he does. He was created to be that way, see? And look, and there's something else that the world will agree with, see? They say, well, the devil's going to be destroyed and we'll never see him again forever. Well, Dr. Kinley said, oh, no, that ain't true. Because after this set of second seven ages is gone and a new set of ages come in, hey, he'll just bring that old boy back.
That's right.
Do the same job.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm Yahweh. I change not. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
See, Yahweh, see, the devil's no adversary. The devil is not a, I don't want to say adversary, the devil is not a liability to Yahweh. He's an asset. Necessary asset. To highlight the negative. See, because look, it takes the positive and the negative, just like this light, to see light, to get light.
Mm-hmm.
To get illumination. You have to have both. I mean, it's just in the natural. You have to have light and darkness. You have to have up and down, hot and cold. Mm-hmm. You gotta have these things, you know? And they're not evil. See, negative is not necessarily evil
right.
in itself. See, darkness, you know, is a negative, but it's not necessarily evil. Because, see, darkness, Yahweh said, darkness is my secret pavilion.
Mm-hmm.
My secret pavilion.
Yeah.
See, that's an outer court, or a court round up, my secret pavilion. See, this is a pattern. See, now, let's go back to Revelations, the 21st. Oh, no, finish reading the Romans, I'm sorry.
And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
Mm-hmm.
For until the law, sin was in the world.
For until the law, now see, now, until the law. See, now what law? The law from Mount Sinai, 613 ordinances. But sin was in the world prior to this, but it came in by one man. Prior to the transgression, there was no sin.
Mm-hmm.
But sin is not imputed when there is no law.
But sin is not imputed or is not charged where there is no law. Now there's a law. The law pointed it out. The law will increase it. The law, because look, they got condemned here.
Yeah.
They died, you know, up here in their conscience. And condemnation, there it is, come out, condemned. Only thing the law did was increase that condemnation. See, it just increased, I mean, to the point of like, I mean, look, no Israelite. No, and that's the thing, that's another thing. People are still holding on to these ordinances. And see, when you understand it, no human being on earth has ever been able Moses' law, saving he, the one who gave it. That was the only reason why he could move out the way.
Mm-hmm.
Because he could perform it. He did the duty of the Israelites and performed this for them and moved out this Old Testament, Old Covenant, to bring in a new one. But he was the only one that could do it. I mean, nobody else could. Solomon, wise as he was, couldn't do it. Abraham, you know, full of faith. You know, I mean, but he wasn't under the law, was he? Neither. That's another thing people don't think about is dispensations. There's a lot of things, you know, we don't agree with in the world. See? But get Romans. I mean, Revelations, 21st chapter. Let me go back to that. I wanted to bring that up about the sin. Because, see, look, sin is a transgression of the law. All right? And look, there was no sin committed on Mother Earth prior to Adam and Eve sinning up here in the garden.
Yeah.
That's why when once they did sin, then the earth was cursed for man's sake.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's why when Cain, see, that's part of the reason why his offering was not accepted. Really for three reasons, actually. Because see, Abel sacrificed the lamb and brought blood. See, that's in accordance with what happened with Moses. Because when the law was spoken down from Mount Sinai, and they made a covenant. Yahweh made a covenant with Israel. It was sealed by blood. They sacrificed. It was by blood. That's what happened with Abel. Prefigured up here. Abel prefigured that. So without shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin.
Mm-hmm.
So now here comes Cain, you know. He's the farmer. And he's going to say, well, I'm going to bring you some, you know, some apples, some oranges, some pumpkins, some watermelons. I'm going to offer my, you know, offer this stuff.
Yeah.
And it's rejected. And he's like, oh, look at my food. I eat something there. See, trying to play it off. But see, but what was on his mind? One, the ground had been cursed for man's sake. So he's bringing us some cursed fruit, for one thing, offering us some cursed fruit. Two, there ain't no blood in fruit. Without shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin.
Right.
See, also, he was out of order. Because according to the pattern, see, he's bringing forth the first fruits. That ain't how the pattern starts. It starts with a death, starts with blood, then a burial, then a resurrection, which is what the first fruits signify.
Mm-hmm.
He was out of order. He's coming up with the resurrection. And I'm coming up with the blood. In other words, he didn't want to remit his sins. In other words, he was self-exalted. See the point?
Mm-hmm.
Without shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. But since he didn't shed any blood, he didn't remit no sin, because in his mind, he's like, well, you know,
yeah,
I'm just doing this to be doing this. I got nothing to remit, you know, in his heart. And then when it was rejected, who did he blame? He didn't blame him. He blamed Abel. He went over there and killed him. Took his shepherd's cloak and killed his brother. But see, but that's all part of the purpose.
Yeah.
Okay, Now I want Revelation 21:1. Read that. Now I'm going to explain to you the explanation our founder gave on this particular chapter.
Revelations 21:1.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away.
Put your finger there. Get 2 Corinthians 12:1. The other one. Come on now.
2 Corinthians 12:1. It is not expedient for me doubtless to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of Yahweh. I knew a man in the Messiah about 14 years ago, whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell. Yahweh knew it. Such an one caught up to the third heaven. And I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body I cannot tell. Yahweh knew it. That he was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable words, which it is not lawful for a man to utter.
Okay, that's good enough. So now he's caught up into the third heaven. And listen, the religious folks, they can't explain to you what the third heaven is. They don't know. Because they ain't got a pattern.
Yeah.
See? So now this is the third heaven. Then that would preclude that there's a first heaven and a second heaven. First, second, third heaven.
Yeah.
Now, go back to Revelations 1:21:1.
The first earth was passed away, and there was no more sea.
21:1. Okay.
You want me to start it again?
Yeah.
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away.
Now, here's the migratory tract, which is the greater and more perfect tabernacle, which is the universe. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, because the first heaven and the first earth were passed away.
Right.
John up here on Isle of Patmos, remember, he is confirming everything Moses and the prophets is writing. And he's looking back on this. So he's looking back at the Israelites passing through the divided waters of the Red Sea. And the first heaven and the first earth passed away. And there was no more sea, meaning that they had went through the Red Sea and they were on their way to Mount Sinai. The Red Sea was behind them. Now, that's the explanation Dr. Kinley gave on that, on what this is, because this is John confirming what Moses is writing. Read.
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from Yahweh out of the heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
Now, put your finger there and get, I think it's Exodus, 34th chapter perhaps. Start at 34:27.
34:27.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, write thou these words, for above the tenor of these words I have made a covenant with thee and with Israel. And he was there with Yahweh 40 days and 40 nights.
Now listen, this is Moses' third trip up the mountain. And he's getting a rerun of the vision that he saw in the second trip. But now, remember, when he went up on the second trip, he came down with the first tables of stone. See, remember, he saw the Israelites worshiping a golden calf. And he broke the tables of stone. Put your finger there just to simply go back to 34:1. Exodus 34:1.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, hew thee 2 tables of stone like unto the first, and I will write upon these tables the words that were in the first tables, which thou breakest.
Okay, now, that's the reason, see? Because he broke the first, so now he's gone back up on the third trip. He's got another tables of stone unwritten on. And look, the first tables of stone came out of an indentation in the mount. See, it was cut out of the mount by Yahweh and written on and given to Moses. The new set Moses is bringing up, it's got to fit in the same spot where the first one came out of, the same indentation.
Yeah.
Because Yahweh's going to write, he's got to put it right in that same spot. Okay? Now, go back and read. 29, come on. It says 28, 34, 28.
And he was there with Yahweh 40 days and 40 nights. He did neither eat bread nor drink water. And he wrote upon the tables the words of the covenant.
He wrote upon the tables the words of the covenant. See, the ones that Moses brought up and put back into the mount. Elohim wrote on that. Mm-hmm. Okay, read.
The Ten Commandments.
Uh-huh.
And it came to pass when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony mm-hmm. in Moses' hand, when he came down from the mount, that Moses wist not that the skin of his face shone when
uh-huh.
he talked with him.
Mm-hmm.
And when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come nigh him. And Moses called unto them, and Aaron and all the rulers of the congregation returned unto him, and Moses talked with them. And afterward, all the children of Israel came nigh, and he gave them in commandment all that Yahweh had spoken with him in Mount Sinai.
Mm-hmm.
Until Moses had done speaking with them, he put a veil on his face.
I said he had to put a veil because he was shining. He was glowing. He was radiating light.
Hmm.
And they could not, he was like the sun. And they couldn't look at him. That moment, look at. And he had to put a, the man had to put a veil on his face.
Hmm.
So now, just picture. Here he is, he's come down the mountain, he's glowing. He's got the tables of stones with him now. He's got tables of stones with him, and he had to put a veil over his face.
Mm-hmm.
So he's got the tables of stone, and he's got a veil over his face. Now go back to Revelations where you left off.
And I heard it.
Where are you?
Revelations 21 and 3.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's do 21 and 2. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, mm-hmm. coming down from Yahweh
uh-huh.
out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
Now that's John looking back, and he's looking back at Moses.
Yeah.
Because he's coming down, and that's what Moses looks like. He's got the tables of stone, like a bouquet of flowers.
Yeah.
And he's got a veil over
him. Mm-hmm.
See, because John is looking back, and he's confirming what's being written. And that's what he's looking at. He's looking at Moses coming, and read.
And I heard a great voice out of the heavens saying, behold, the tabernacle of Yahweh is with man.
Why? Because he came down and he had the specification of the tabernacle with him. And he gave into that, and the tabernacle was with man, right here in the midst of them in the wilderness.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And he will dwell with them,
mm-hmm.
and they shall be his people.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh himself shall be with them and be their Elohim.
See, this is John on the Mount of Patmos looking back and confirming what we read in Exodus. Of what Moses is writing. Okay, read.
And Yahweh shall wipe away all tears from their eyes,
mm-hmm.
and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto me, write, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done, and I am the first and the last, the beginning and the end. And I will give unto him that is a thirst of the fountain of water of life freely.
Mm-hmm.
He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be with his Eloah, I will be his Eloah, and he shall be my son. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable,
mm-hmm.
and murderers,
mm-hmm.
and whoremongers,
mm-hmm.
and sorcerers, and idolaters,
mm-hmm.
and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with the fire and brimstone,
mm-hmm.
which is the second death.
Mm-hmm.
And there came unto me one of the seven angels.
Okay, now hold it right there, because I'll have to get to that in a minute. But I want you to jump over that, and I'll come back to that. Actually, go ahead and read it. Go ahead, because it leads into this other thing, which the world, it goes into this rapture thing that the world believes in, so just go ahead and read.
And there came unto me one of the seven angels,
mm-hmm.
which had the seven vials.
Had the seven vials, read.
Full of the seven last plagues,
mm-hmm.
and talked with me, saying, come hither, I will show thee of the bride, the Lamb's wife.
Now see, people look, they read this stuff in Revelations about the seven bowls, the seven vials, the seven eight, and they think these are things that's going to happen or going to come. Whereas we say, these things already happen. Case in point, the seven vials of wrath, the seven bowls of wrath. See, that was already done down here in Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
If you remember, Yahweh poured out 10 devastating plagues on Egypt,
mm-hmm.
correct?
Mm-hmm.
The first three, the Israelites had to go through them.
Right.
Yeah.
But the last seven, the Israelites were spared of them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
See, so those last seven, they were spared, and not the Egyptians. are correlative to the seven plagues or the seven vials in Revelation, because that's what John is looking back on. Mm-hmm. For him to say that, he has to have a reference. So where's the reference at? The seven plagues down here that was on the Egyptians that the Israelites were not a part of. You see that now? Mm-hmm. See, everything, look, in this scripture, in the Bible itself, these folks are confirming each other. That's why you can say this is all one vision. Yeah. See, man will say this. Well, the Bible was written by man. I was talking to my niece the other day, you know, and we was talking about this, and she was talking to me, well, I think some things in the Bible is true and some things are not true, you know. I'm like, well, wait a minute, well, how do you know which is what? You know? Mm-hmm. How do you know? And besides, the Bible is verified for this simple reason. There's a science called archaeology. In other words, you know, that's talking about digging up stuff, you know, finding relics, antiquities from the past. Hey, the things that are mentioned in the Bible, they have found these things. Hey, there is such a thing as the city of Jerusalem, isn't it? You know? You know, it's Jerusalem. There was such, I mean, you read about Babylon. Was there such thing as Babylon?
Yeah.
You know, Medes and Persians, Chaldees, you know, you read about them, you know. You read about, you know, these different places and stuff in the Bible. And they put the ark. I said, oh, well, here it is. Like Nineveh is one of the oldest cities in the world. They found that. It was one of the biggest cities in the world at that time. Mm-hmm. And they were surprised, you know, because first they didn't think it existed, and then they found it, and the archaeologists were surprised at how large this city really was. I mean, it was a metropolitan place, you know?
Yeah.
So these things, these places did exist. See, and that's, you can't, you know, I mean, I mean, they found coins from David's era, Solomon's era. I mean, you know, these people existed.
Yeah.
Well, you're going to say, oh, well, the Bible's fake, you know, man wrote the Bible. Well, man was the secretary, but they didn't come up with it. See, it was the Word. They just wrote down what the Word told them. Hmm. See? So therefore, it's the Word who's the author of the Bible. Therefore, it would have to be the Word or the author to explain the Bible to you, which is Elohim, the archetype, original pattern of the universe. That's who you explain. See, that's why we say, while there's many versions of the Bible, there's only one prophetic vision. Mm-hmm. And when you understand what that vision is, then it doesn't matter what Bible you're talking about. You know, you got the pattern and the vision to look at. Let's read some more quickly. Where are you at? Revelations.
And there came unto me one of the seven angels.
No, 21 and 5.
No, jump down to 10.
And he carried me away in the spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from Yahweh, having the glory of Yahweh, and her light was like unto a stone most precious, even a jasper stone.
Now see, now this is
clear,
what,
and clear as crystal.
This is what the Christians believe. This is part of their rapture thing, see? Which is why they don't like Barack Obama too much, because he's the Antichrist, you know, who got reelected, you know. Mm-hmm. It was supposed to be a fluke, you know. And, you know, I find it funny, some of the excuses, because they said, well, he wouldn't have won if Hurricane Sandy hadn't came about. It was an act of God. I said, well, if that be the case, that means God wanted Obama to be president. So why are you complaining?
Yeah.
And if he is the Antichrist like you believe he is, you should re-elect him, because if he's the Antichrist, that means the rapture is right around the corner. Don't you want to be raptured unless you're not ready? Oh, that's what it is. You're afraid you'll be left behind. Mm. But the rest of us non-believers.
Yeah.
You know? And that would expose you all along. You were lying all along. You thought you was a Christian, and then all of a sudden you got left behind. You're like, oh no, oh please, Lord, come get me out. No, don't leave me behind, Lord. See, that's the rapture. See, because they believe, and that's another thing. See, they believe that the earth abided forever, and that everybody's going to be living in this paradise, you know, like the Jehovah's Witnesses think that we're going to rip up all these buildings and roads and stuff, and it's going to be a nature. It's going to be like the Garden of Eden worldwide, yeah. And we'll be walking around in white robes and, you know, and, you know, petting the deer as we go by and, you know, all this kind of stuff, you know. That's what they think. Mm-hmm. A physical paradise. In fact, most religions believe in a physical paradise. Mm-hmm. See? You know, not just Christians. The Jews believe it too. The Muslims believe in it. The Buddhists.
It's easier.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Because they think it's, you know, it's right here. You know, I mean, because they do not have a metaphysical sense of anything beyond the physical.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask you one?
Yes. Go ahead, ma'am.
When they say Obama being the first black man, he's just as much white as he is black. So why he got to be the first black man? Why can't he just be the first man?
Because traditionally, in this, because of the history of this country, one drop of black blood makes you black. Mm-hmm. See, and in fact, not only did it make you black, not only did it qualify you to be black, it qualified you to be a slave. Mm-hmm. Okay. See, that's the difference. And it's because of that tradition. Now, of course, that's changed for some folks, because I've met people, you know, and, you know, later on, who some white people who feel like, well, why should the black be dominant? Why can't he be, he's just as much white as he is black, you know? It's 50-50, why does the black have to be dominant, you know? But see, that's, but I'm telling you the reason why is because of tradition.
Yeah.
You know, because one drop of black blood makes you black. And see, people don't realize how much mixed we really are. I mean, gosh, you know. I mean, I did a DNA scan several years back. I did a couple of them, actually. I did one with AfricanAncestry.com. They're in D.C. What they do, they take your DNA. They send you, you have to pay some money, too. But they'll send you a kit and some swabs, and you have to swab your mouth so many times, and they'll get the saliva because that has your DNA, and you send it in. And they do these little tests, you know, it takes you several weeks, and they'll match you up with what, in their database of the DNA samples they have of African tribes. And so, you know, and they line up your well, fine, since I'm a man, they line up my Y chromosome and, you know, the marker on there, and they said that the predominant marker on my Y chromosome matched up with the Yoruba peoples of Africa. And the X chromosome, which I got from my mother, which is called the mitochondrial, they matched that up, and they said it was matched up with the Fulani people of Africa. So that's, you know, for myself. And so I told that to my family. Of course, you know, it costs some money to do because it's expensive. But it was heartening to know, you know, because all I heard was stories about this, that, and the other. And I did another one. It was this place out of Florida. It's called Ancestry by DNA. And they do a more general thing. And they also have more of a European historical database. So when I did it with them, they did the results, and they sent me back a disc, and I played it, and they said that I was 74, they said I was 74% African, 24% European, and 2% Native American. Mm-hmm. So that means I'm one quarter white. Mm-hmm. I looked that up on the internet, you know, because, you know, you have them old terms, you know, like mulatto, octoroons, and stuff like that, mm-hmm. And I looked it up to see what, well, what's the term for a person who's three quarter black and one quarter white, and the term is a Zambo. Zambo, Zambo, you know, so I can imagine, you know, hey, where's that Zambo coming down the street there? You know, I could start a restaurant, you know, and say, yeah, get Uncle Will's barbecue with that Zambo sauce, you know. But I understand that because, see, my great-grandmother was white, mm-hmm. You know, and so that's the reason why, so.
So if your father is full-blooded Portuguese and your mother's Indian, Irish, and black, then where do you stand?
Well, see, the thing is with heredity and genetics, see, there's infinite, near infinite combinations of traits, you know. You can, you know, I used to know a guy when I grew up. This guy was dark. He was as dark as Frank back there. You know, and there's nothing wrong with that. But he had pure green eyes. It was a trip. Yeah. We used to call him Cat Daddy. Mm-hmm. You know, but he was, you know, I mean, but you could, I mean, he had some, you know, mixed answers, but I'm just saying the combinations, you never know, you know. You could be white as, you know, snow and have nappy hair if you have mixed blood. You know what I'm saying? Because the combination is not going to be like, well, this trait of black and this trait of white, just, you know. No, they switch off. They pair off and they, you know, so it could be any combination of things, you know.
Yeah.
Never, you know, so, and see, and there's no such thing really as a pure blood, and there never was a pure blood, what they call race of people, you know. Mm-hmm. And I know Dr. Kinley, he did it in a simplified way, just to show forth the purpose of the pattern. Like, he would say this, because Adam was placed in the midst of the garden, mm-hmm. All right, and in the midst of the garden, it was surrounded by four rivers that proceeded from the garden. Mm-hmm. And see, from what Dr. Kinley would say, that was like the four races of man that proceeded out of this one man, Adam,
yeah.
in which he considered the black, the white, the red, and the yellow.
Yeah.
And he used to say this, that every race had its day on the earth. He said every race has their skills and talents, and every race has had their day of dominance in the sun. Mm-hmm. You know. He also said that Nimrod was a black man. That's where I got that from. See, he was a black man. And that every race had its day on the earth, and he also said that if time would go on, you know, the black man would have his ascendancy again. You know, as, mm-hmm. you know, in the circular history of things. You know, so mm-hmm. that's how he looked at that. But basically, you know, as far as there's very little difference between us as human beings. I mean, the color thing. You know, came in about by, who was it? It was a Swedish scientist named Linnaeus. And he was the one that came up with the terms like Caucasoid, Mongoloid, Negroid, and that type of thing, and classifications. And he would look at people's, you know, the cranial structure, the size of the brain, the head, and the shape of, you know, the all of that. He did all of that kind of stuff, you know, and say, well, there's a little difference between the Caucasians, the Mongoloid, and the Negroid. And, you know, and as long as the Negroid are the lesser of all the three, and, you know, and that's how all this race stuff got started,
yeah.
you know, and IQ tests, intelligence, and stuff like that, you know, and really it was during the time when slavery was getting started here in America, so they would use the scientific stuff to justify, well, you know, these guys, well, they don't have the endowments, you know, like the whites do, or they'd get biblical and say, you know, well, look in the Bible, it says, servants of service shalt thou be, you know, it's obvious you're the children of Ham, aren't you? Yeah, well, you know, it was in that movie, Lincoln, they did a little trailer where some guy was screaming about, why would you pass a law to make a group of people equal that God made unequal?
Yeah, yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
That kind of thing, you know. And there's some people that believe that to this day, you know. Mm-hmm. They want to see that because, you know, this is America. It's a country that was started by God's people, you know. You know, chosen people syndrome again, you know. That's real prevalent in the world,
yeah.
you know. Because, you know, you think you're a chosen person. Well, we can do what we want to do because God is smiling on us, you know. Mm-hmm. God has got our back, you know, that kind of thing, you know. So
skin color is the least thing.
Yeah, it's the least variable of all.
The least variable.
I mean, that's what the scientists will tell you. But, but in the 19th century, that's what they use as the major determining factor to divide up the races,
yeah.
you know, by your skin color and such. But again, you know, what we want to do is look at the divine metaphysical aspects of these things. Okay, sure, we want to get into the history class and show, you know, how these things come about. But as far where are we at? Are we in the scriptures?
Yes.
Yeah, I want to get back to that. Yeah, because it's talking about this city. And see, and what John is looking at, he's looking at the Israelites and this tabernacle back here in the wilderness, okay? And that's what he's looking at, keep reading. Where you at?
11. And the glory of Yahweh and her light was like unto a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal, and had a wall great and high,
mm-hmm.
and had 12 gates, and at the 12 gates angels, and the names written thereon, which are on the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. On the east 3 gates, on the north 3 gates, on the south 3 gates, and on the west 3 gates. And the wall of the city had 12 fountains, and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And he that talked with me had a golden reed to measure the city, and the gates thereon, and the wall thereon. And the city lieth 4 square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed, and 12,000 furlongs, the length and the breadth and the height of it are equal. And he measured the wall thereon, 144 cubits, according to the measure of man, that is, of the angel.
Okay, that's the key right there. Because see, these Christians would read that, and they think, well, see, this is part of the rapture. Because after the 1,000 years is over and the Antichrist is overthrown, then God and Jesus is going to bring his bride back down. It's the great city, this golden city. He's going to bring it back down. And I did the dimensions thing. It was like 12,000 furlongs. That's about the size of the state of Oregon. And this great city is going to come down and, you know, and then land, land on earth. And then, all the people that'll be after all the people are resurrected from the graves, right? Because Jesus is going to come back and he's going to catch us in the air. So all the graves are going to pop open and people are going to be, standing up and floating up in the air, Now, I guess they'll be floating up in the air when this other city's floating down, But that's how they're looking at this, so. But the point is that John's looking at it, he says it's the measure of a man that is of the angel. What man? What angel? This man. And I'm pointing to him, the high priest, because he's got on the breastplate, with all the stones on it, because it's going to tell you, it's got this stone and that stone. And people think it's an actual sign. No, it's not. It's talking about the measure of a man. It's talking about the pattern. Because what you got back here, you got the Israelites, the 12 tribes, they're surrounding this tabernacle. You got the tabernacle in the midst of them. In the midst of that, you got the high priest officiating, wearing his garments of beauty and glory, with the mitre, saying holiness to Yahweh. The two stones, the Urim and the Thurim, in his shoulders. The breastplate with the 12 stones on it, wearing the ephod. And at the bottom, he's got bells and pomegranates on the hilt. That's what John is looking at. But people think it's an actual city made out of gold. I mean, God, I don't know. Could you live in a city made of gold? Gold is too malleable. It's kind of soft. I mean, probably, on a hot day, you could probably, sit in there, really. This is what John is describing. He's describing this back. He's looking back and looking at this.
Yeah.
Read.
And the building of the wall of it was of jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass.
Mm-hmm.
And the fountains of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stone. The first fountain was jasper, the second sapphire, the third a chalcedony, and the fourth an emerald, the fifth a sardonyx, and the sixth sardius, and the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth of topaz, the tenth of chrysoprasus, and the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was one pearl, and the street of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass. And I saw no temples therein, for Yahweh, El Shaddai, the Lamb, are the temple of it.
See, that's the point. He himself is the temple. That's what John is looking at. But people think it's like it's some city.
Yeah.
Big giant city with 12 gates and all, it's looking at this man here. That's what he's looking at. Read on.
And I saw no temple, and the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon, to shine in it, for the glory of Yahweh had lighted it, and the Lamb is the light thereof.
Now look, go back here into the wilderness. What was happening back here in the wilderness with the light situation?
A pillar of fire by night.
What?
I'm
talking about in the wilderness. In the wilderness. They
had light because the cloud was a pillar
of light by
night. By night.
Yes, fire
see,
by night.
It was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night.
Mm-hmm.
See, so they didn't need the light. See, that's what John is talking about. He's looking back and that's what he's talking about.
Yeah.
He's confirming what Moses is writing about. Okay? Read on.
Can I have a question?
Yes.
In Arabia, is that sand?
No, this is a mountain.
No. I mean,
here?
In the wilderness of Sinai.
No, not sand, not necessarily. Because there were, in a wilderness you have some growth, maybe not a whole lot sparse, it's like a desert.
Yeah, but I mean the coloring.
What, this coloring?
Yeah, it could be yellow.
Well, I don't know about, I don't, well.
Because
I didn't paint this chart, so.
No, I don't mean that, because they're sand and the ground or the
was it?
The street. The street was pure gold, or transparent glass.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking, okay, I can imagine the Serengeti or something being all gold. It looks.
No, but see, John is just looking. He's looking back at this tabernacle,
yeah.
not just the tabernacle, but the temple as well. All right, he's just looking back on this. See. There's one scripture in there that says it talks about a sea of glass. See, a sea of glass. And seeing people say, well, what is that about? Well, see, again, John's looking back. This would be the sea of glass.
Mm.
Talking about the Red Sea.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be the sea of glass. And there's a scripture, it's in this, Revelation about the fire. We're going to say, well, see, well, look. The Egyptians saw that cloud through the Red Sea, and it was like a divine fire. I mean, because look, they went right into the Red Sea and they drowned in there. And that is like Satan and his host, like we have over here, being cast into the outer darkness.
Mm-hmm.
Pharaoh and his host going into the Red Sea is the same as Lucifer and his host being cast out here. It's the same thing in principle.
Yeah.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that was just an addition. I don't know if that really answered your question.
You were saying people are taking, they are trying to look at something physically. So, and his descriptions are the way they spoke,
mm-hmm.
not necessarily what they, you know.
Well, see, this is the argument Christianity has. In fact, some Christians would even tell you that Revelation shouldn't even be part of the Bible simply because they don't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then that's why they say apocalyptic.
Yeah.
See, meaning it's a mystery.
Yeah.
See, it's hidden, and they don't understand it. But most people tend to think, well, this is stuff that's going to happen. Some people think some certain things have already happened when it talks about the mark of the beast and the Antichrist. Some people are smart enough to at least see, oh, well, you know, this. He's talking about back in the pagan Roman Empire with Emperor Nero. Because he had the mark of the beast on there. See, you can have, which it does apply to him, but that mark goes all the way down through the ages and dispensations, all the way down to, you know, to here. They don't even agree with the interpretation of Daniel's dream as far as those kingdoms. You know, we got Babylon, Medes and Persians, Greek, pagan Rome, papal Rome. They wouldn't have it like that. They would say that they wouldn't say papal Rome. They would just say, they have everything else. They would say Babylon, Medes and Persia, Greece, but the Christians would say, instead of pagan Rome, papal Rome, they would just have pagan Rome for both legs, and one leg would be the Eastern Empire, and the other leg would be the Western Empire, but it would still be pagan. Yes, sir, Dr. Frank.
Okay, the scripture that you're talking about is Revelation 4.
Let's read it.
4 and 6.
Let's read it.
Revelation 4 and 6. Mm-hmm. And before the throne was a sea of glass like unto crystal. In the midst of the throne and round about the throne were four beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion.
Mm-hmm.
And the second beast like a calf. Third beast had a face as a man. And the fourth beast was like a flying eagle.
Now, isn't that the pattern? Don't
yeah.
we talk about the enzymes?
We sure do.
Yeah.
It's the same thing. That's what John is looking at. And so that's where he's looking back on. That's why the sea of glass here that he's talking about, that's the Red Sea. Because the Israelites came through that. Because that's the way Dr. Kennedy explained it. In fact, there used to be a chart. It was in the first edition of his textbook where he had a chart where he showed the sea of glass, you know, where he showed that. But that's what he's talking about. Because, see, read that again. Talk about there was 24 elders, see, 12 tribes, 12 apostles, you know, and then.
That's Revelations 14, 21, 14.
21, 14. Why are you
reading that? He said that the.
4 and 4, where we were at?
Mm-hmm.
How did you get
and the first beast was like a lion.
Yeah.
And the second beast like a calf.
Uh-huh.
And the third beast to the face is a man.
See, that's the enzyme. See,
and
remember?
The fourth beast was like a flying eagle.
See, that's the
four tribes.
What is my book?
Give
me a textbook. This is, all right, let's show you right quick. Page 80, I think it's 81, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yep, page 81. Here we go. In the textbook. It's the illustration, see? See, here it is. Here's the here's the lion, which is Judah. Mm-hmm. See, and here's the calf, or the bull up here, which is Ephraim. And here's the eagle over here, which is Dan. And then here's the man over here, which is Reuben. See, that's what John is confirming. See, in fact, this is what Dr. Kinley wrote in his book. Just read the caption under it. See, this is what Dr. Kinley wrote.
John, and before the throne there was a sea of glass.
No, read this.
He's trying to hear. Then the tabernacle of the congregation so set forward the camp of the Levites in the midst of the camp. As they encamp, so shall they set forward every man in his place by their standards.
Now, what scripture is that?
That's just says Numbers 2:17.
Okay, now that's in the wilderness, see? Now Dr. Kinley quoted that, and here's the corollary to that.
Revelations 4:6-8.
Mm-hmm.
And before the throne there was a sea of glass,
mm-hmm.
brazen laver, like unto crystal, and in the midst of the throne, and round about the throne, were four beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, and the second beast like a calf, and the third beast had a face as a man, and the fourth beast was like a flying eagle, and the four beasts had each of them six wings about him, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Yahweh Almighty, which was and is to come.
Okay. Now, that's the caption that Dr. Kinley, that's the correlation that Dr. Kinley put there under that illustration, mm-hmm. to show forth that what Moses is writing about back here and what John wrote about are one and the same.
Mm-hmm.
That's the point on that. Okay? Now, go back to, we were in the 21st.
21, 24.
No, I want to address something while I got a little more time. Go back to 21 and 9 and read that.
21 and 9.
Mm-hmm.
And there came unto me one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues,
mm-hmm.
and talked with me, saying, Come hither, I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain.
Stop. Okay, now, talk about the seven angels that had the seven vials, okay? And we brought it up that refers to the seven plagues down here that the Egyptians, experienced, that the Israelites did not. Now, here's my correlation. And you can take it for what it's worth, investigate or whatever, What I've looked at as far as the seven, go to Revelations 6:1. See, when you go into Revelations, it talks about seven vials, seven bowls of wrath, seven angels, seven. And so, what is it talking about? So, if John is looking back on this thing, we say this, Moses is looking at the thing from beginning to ending. And John is looking at the thing from the ending back to the beginning. So if that be the case, then what John is looking back on is this whole scope of dispensations and ages. See, not only is he looking back, but he's looking ahead as well in some case, because what's ahead is the same thing that has already happened in principle. Okay? Read.
6:1, and I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, Come and see. And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him.
Mm-hmm.
And he went forth conquering and to conquer. And when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast saying, Come and see. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him.
Okay, now hold it up. I want to get on that one horse. Now, the first horse was a white horse. They went out to conquer, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the Christians think this is going to happen, and they're looking for it. Some guy, you look up. But see, this has already happened. See, how do I know this? Because I can go back and look at the ages and dispensations, okay? I can look here. There are seven ages. There are seven dispensations, right?
Mm-hmm.
Here, the guy that went out to conquer was Cain. He went out and ruled the world. We got the illustration, got the chart. He built a city, Ravenna, mm-hmm. and put a crown on his head, and he ruled.
Yeah.
He went out and conquered. That was in the first, the Adamic dispensation, okay? Now, keep your finger there. I want the other one to read this chapter. Read the Revelations 8 and 6. Start with two, quickly, because I'm running out of time.
8 and 2. And I saw the seven angels which stood before Yahweh, and to them were given seven trumpets.
Okay, now to them was given seven trumpets. Now the other one is seven seals. Now here's seven trumpets. Now the Christians believe these events happen one after another. What I'm trying to show is that these events are happening simultaneously and have already happened through the dispensations and ages. Mm-hmm. Okay, quickly. Jump down to 6. Verse.
And the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound.
Mm-hmm.
The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood. And they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of the trees was burnt up, and all grass grew, and all green grass was burnt up.
Okay, so now, the first trumpet that we already read about, the first horse and the other one on the seal. What are you talking about? Well, in the first dispensation, see, it was already brought out how the earth had already been... These angels, these demons have been cast down here and sin entered into the world. And so now it says that the third part of the trees was burnt up and all green grass was burnt up. What are you talking about?
Man.
Well, trees, which is part of the vegetable kingdom, the plant kingdom, is a type of angels. So it says one third of the trees were burnt up. That tells you that one third of the heavenly, that was cast down here. That one third. And all green grass was burnt up. What do you mean? That's the man. The green grass is man. See, there's a scripture in Isaiah where it talks about what is man. You know, what if you cut him down like a flower? You know, all is like grass. You know, see, that's what it's talking about here. See, what I'm doing is you're taking one seal, one trumpet, and you're comparing it with the first dispensation, the events that happened here. Now, go back and read the second seal. Second seal.
And the second angel sounded, as it were, a great mountain burning with the fire, and was cast into the sea. And the third part of the sea became blood. And the third part of the creature, which were in the sea, and the life died. And the third part of the ships were destroyed. And the angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven.
Hold on, stop. I want one trumpet at a time. Okay, now that's the second trumpet you read. Now I want the second seal. Second seal.
And when he had opened the second, that's 6 and 3, and when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, "Come and see." And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another, and there was given unto him a great sword.
Okay, so now that's the second dispensation. That's the Noahic dispensation. Mm-hmm. Because she read the other one about the trumpets, it says, and this, there was an 8 and 8 and 8, and the second angel sounded, and it was a word, great mountain burning with fire, and cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became with blood. Well, what happened in the second dispensation? Wasn't it the flood?
Right.
Yeah. See? And see, and also, when we read about the seal, it said that there was, it says there was, they should, there was violence, they should kill one another. Well, what was going on back here within the second dispensation? When you read Genesis 6 and 3, it says there was violence in the earth.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. See? In other words, there was, you know, there was those who were of Cain hunting those or perpetrating violence against those who believe in the truth or who believe in Elohim. Mm-hmm. See? But what I'm showing you, but the point I'm trying to make is you're comparing each one of these things with the dispensations. Okay? Now, read the third trumpet.
And the third part of the creature, which were in the sea and had, no. And the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp. And it fell upon the third part of the river, and upon the fountains of water. And the name of the star is called Wormwood. And the third part of the waters became wormwood, and many men died of the waters because they were made bitter.
Okay, now read the third seal.
And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hurt not the oil and the wine.
Okay, so now, what happened in the third dispensation here? See, this is Melchizedek, priesthood, and Abrahamic promise. So what the events happened in the third dispensation? Wasn't there a famine? In fact, wasn't there three famines? There was a famine during Abraham's life, a famine during Isaac's life, and a famine during Jacob's life. One famine forced Jacob and his family to migrate down here to Egypt.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, also we read in about the trumpet that said that, and the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as though it were a lamp, and it fell upon the third part of the waters and upon the fountains of waters. What are you talking about? Well, in the third dispensation, didn't Pharaoh drown in the Red Sea? He was a type of Lucifer, type. I'm talking about Pharaoh.
Yeah.
He's a type of Lucifer, a star, mm-hmm. and so he drowned in the Red Sea.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You see, John is confirming what Moses is writing,
yeah.
and seeing this is what you're just showing how it's just lining up with the dispensations.
Mm-hmm.
That's all you're doing. You're just co-relating. And that's another thing Dr. Kennedy introduced that the world don't know anything about, correlating events. Because people think events in the Bible is hodgepodge, this, that, that, and don't understand that they're all correlated. They don't understand that.
Mm-hmm.
Let's read.
The fourth seal?
The
fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the part of the stars. So as the third part of them was darkened,
mm-hmm.
and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. And I beheld and heard the eagle flying through the midst of the heavens, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reasons of the other voices of the trumpets of the three angels which had yet to sound.
Okay, fourth seal.
And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death, and Hell followed with him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth, to kill with sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beasts of the earth.
Okay, now, here's the fourth dispensation. What happened here? See, the fourth dispensation is when the law was given, right? And what did we tell you the law did?
Made
by Moses' law.
Made sin more exceedingly sinful.
It made sin more exceedingly sinful. Mm-hmm. And see, and what was said about Moses' law? He who despised Moses' law died mm-hmm. under that law,
mm-hmm.
under two or three witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
See, the penalty for breaking Moses' law was death. And we told you that no one was able to keep Moses' law,
mm-hmm.
right? So they all died. And then you said death and Hades, but actually it's death and the grave. Because there's no such thing as hell. That's a Greek thing. See, you talk to a Jew about hell, you know, about Hades, he wouldn't know. I mean, I'm talking about, you know, he does know. I mean, we live in America, but theologically speaking, there's no such thing as hell or Hades in the Hebrew scriptures. See, the word is Sheol, or the grave. So death and the grave. See, why? Because that's what that law did. See, you were already dead, see, and then so you need to be buried. Because, see, under the fourth dispensation, people were dead and people were buried. Didn't John the Baptist bury these folks?
Because
mm-hmm. when you came to John the Baptist, you couldn't just say, okay, John, I'm here as a candidate for baptism, etc. No. You had to publicly admit
mm-hmm.
that you could not perform or perform Moses' law. In
mm-hmm.
effect, you had to publicly admit that you was dead.
Mm-hmm.
And so John, being the nice guy that he is, he said, well, look here, brother, since you publicly admit that you're dead, I'm going to do you a service. I'm going to bury you. Gonk, he dunk you in the water.
Mm.
And then when he brought you back up, I'm going to bury you until I'm going to bury you until the Messiah's death. And then he raised you back up so that when you resurrect, you will be in the likeness of his resurrection. We got time. Read that. Romans 6 and 3, just to emphasize that point, because we're out of time. But I want just to show you that the scriptures is not imperceptible.
Mm-hmm.
If you take the time to look at the things, you know, like the pattern, law of the prophets, correlating events, Okay, read.
Know you not that so many of us that were baptized into Yahshua the Messiah were baptized into his death?
See, that's what John did. He would, they would have, the Jews had to admit they were dead, and John would baptize these dead Jews unto the Messiah's death. Mm-hmm. Read.
Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into mm-hmm. death, that like as the Messiah was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life.
Mm-hmm.
For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death,
mm-hmm.
we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection.
In the likeness of his resurrection. See? Okay? Now let's go back. The fifth seal or fifth trumpet, whoever can get there first.
And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw the star that had fallen from heaven unto
mm-hmm.
the earth,
mm-hmm.
and to him was given the keys to, of the abyss. And he opened the abyss, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, and as the smoke of the great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and to them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of Yahweh in their forehead. And to them it was given that they should not kill them,
mm-hmm.
but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion, which when he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shape of the locusts were like unto a horse, prepared unto battle, and on their heads were, as it were, crowns like gold, their faces were as the faces of men. And they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions. And they had breastplates, as it were breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots, of many horses running into battle. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and their in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit.
Now, what angel would that be?
That would be Satan.
See, the one that was cast down there,
mm-hmm.
which is here. Because
yeah.
guess what?
This is the bottomless
pit. We're in the bottomless pit, too.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
See? So now he, but the Lucifer is the angel of the bottomless pit. Read.
Whose name is in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue has his name Apollyon.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now that's good.
The destroyer.
That's right. That's what it means. It means the destroyer. Okay? So now read the seal.
And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of Yahweh and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Yahweh, holy and true,
mm-hmm.
dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth?
Mm-hmm.
And white robes were given unto every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season, until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled.
Okay, now, that points out to the fifth dispensation. What happened? Well, the Holy Spirit poured out on the day of Pentecost. But also up to this point, see, we read the other one where the angel was loosed from the bottomless pit. Quickly read Revelation 20:1, and we'll be about out of here.
Revelation.
And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit,
mm-hmm.
and a great chain on his hand.
A great chain in his hand. What chain? The chain is these seven dispensations.
Yeah.
These seven dispensations are like links in a chain, and
mm-hmm.
that's what's binding Satan,
mm-hmm.
each link of the chain. That's why we can go back and do what we did. Take the seven trumpets, the seven seals, and all the other seven vials, and lay them on the dispensations. Why? Because you're showing in each dispensation the binding of Satan.
Mm-hmm.
And see, right now we're at the sixth link. So when we get to the seventh link, that will bind him in. That will, hey, look, and once he's bound, we collectively will give him the boot
mm-hmm.
into the lake of fire.
Mm-hmm.
See? Yeah, we got that illustrated over there. Okay? Now, yeah, read that quickly so we can get out of here.
What?
And he laid hold on the dragon, the old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years.
What do you mean? See, that happened on the day of Yahshua's resurrection. Mm-hmm. And see, 1,000 years is the same as one day. So the day that Yahshua resurrected from the grave is the day that Satan was bound. What does that mean? See, that means that all these scribes and Pharisees, of whom were incarnated with the satanic spirit, they sequestered themselves in the temple the day Yahshua resurrected. And they didn't come out that whole day. See, and not only Yahshua resurrected, but all those who died in the faith, from Adam to John the Baptist, resurrected with him and walked into the city and was seen by many. But during that time, those scribes and Pharisees, they stayed off the streets. See, showing that they were bound for that day. See, read quickly.
And cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years shall be fulfilled.
Mm-hmm.
And after that he must be loosed and will seal it.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw thrones and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them.
That's good enough. See, and so he was loosed a little season. We're still in that little season right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now what she had read, the trumpet, the fifth trumpet, and says that, read that again, 9 and 1, quickly.
And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw the star that had fallen from heaven unto the earth.
Wait, say, read that again.
The fifth angel sounded, and I saw the star that had fallen from heaven unto the earth. And to him was given the keys of the abyss.
Mm-hmm.
And he opened the abyss, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, and the smoke of the great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth.
Now, see, what are you talking about? See, out of the pit, what do you mean? See, remember, after the day of resurrection, then after that day, the scribes and the Pharisees came out, and they went out and told the lie and said, look, what happened was his disciples stole the body away. See, they had to secure these guards, see, because see they were sleeping on duty, and see, if you ever been in the military, you can get shot for that. You know?
Yeah.
So in other words, the scribes and the Pharisees had to pay off their superiors and say, look, you know, this is the story we want out. His disciples came and stole the body away. Mm-hmm. See, that was the lie. Okay? Read.
And unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power.
Mm-hmm.
And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree.
Now what did we tell you what the green things and the grass represented? It represented the soul. But see, but this is after the day of Pentecost. They're full of the Holy Spirit. So now he's telling them, well, don't hurt those things because they got the Holy Spirit. But what?
But only those men which have not the seal.
Which have not the seal or have not the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
See that now?
Yeah.
See, read.
As to them it was given that they should not kill them, mm-hmm. but that they should be tormented 5 months.
5 months. Why 5 months? See, 5 months. See, prophetically speaking, a month is 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
See, prophetically speaking, so a month is 30 days and 5 months. That would be 150 days.
Right.
See, why 150 days? Go back to Genesis. I think it's 7, maybe 8. 23, quickly, and then I'll be done. 7 and 23, I'm sorry, my bad. 7 and 23.
And every living substance was destroyed which was upon the face of the ground, both man and cattle, and the creeping things in the fall of the heavens, and they were destroyed from the earth, and Noah only remained alive, and they that were with him in the ark. And the waters prevailed upon the earth 150 days.
Why? Because we read in Revelations that they were told not to hurt the green grass, only those that didn't have the mark. Well, back then, they couldn't hurt Noah because they were safe in the ark.
Mm-hmm.
But just hurt those that weren't out, that were not in the ark.
Yeah.
See, I wish they were dead anyway. But that's the point, see?
Yeah.
See, everything is correlated. That's one thing, boy. I never knew nothing about correlation until Dr. Kinley brought it up. And that was really the key to really understanding the scriptures to show the correlationness.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Of all the stories in the Bible, and that according to a divine pattern of the universe.
Yeah.
Okay? And we're out of time, and thank you very much for being so patient. Yes, sir.
Have you ever heard Revelations 9 and 8 through 11?
Revelations 9 and 8?
8 through 11. Yeah. Interpreted as it being modern day fighter helicopters.
Yeah, oh yeah. In fact, right. I did it myself.
Right.
Back in the day when I used to believe in Lee Warren's doctrine, the Third World War. But see, the thing of it is this. In fact, if we didn't have time, but just to give you a quick read, Revelations 9 and 9 and 7. Nine and 7.
And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads there were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men. And they had hair as the hair of women, and the teeth were as the teeth of lions.
Uh-huh.
And they had breastplates as it were breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was like the sound of chariots of many horses ran into battle.
That's good enough. Now, it said there about, it said that the shape of the locusts were like horses prepared unto battle.
Right.
Get Joel 2 and 4.
Joel 2 and 4.
Start with 3.
And Yahweh sent unto Satan.
Joel 2 and 3.
Oh,
I didn't say Job.
Joel.
I said Joel.
Joel 2 and 4.
2 and 3. Start with 3. Quickly, we're out of time.
Lest I strip her naked.
2 and 3. Joel. You mean Hosea. I know, I didn't say Hosea.
All right, Joel 2 and 3. A fire devours before them, and behind them a flame burneth. The land is as the garden of Eden before them, and behind them a desolate wilderness. Yea, and nothing shall escape them. The appearance of them is as the appearance of horses, and as horsemen so shall they run.
See, that's Revelation. See, can you see that now? He's confirming Joel.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, we read in Revelations, what was that? Revelations 9 and 8. It says, and they had hair like the hair of women, and their teeth were like the teeth of lions. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, get Joel 1 and 6. Joel 1 and 6.
Before their face, the people shall be much pained.
For the nations is come upon my land strong and without number, whose teeth are the teeth of lion, and he has the cheek teeth of the great lion.
See, now that we read that in Revelation. Mm. That's John confirming what Joel writes. And that's what it is with a lot of this stuff. Mm. See, and that's another thing Christianity. I'm a New Testament Christian, you know. But see, not realizing the references in the so-called New Testament that goes all the way back to the old.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Ooh, good class. Mm-hmm.